It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Mr. Speaker, last Thursday, hundreds of families of autistic children came to Queen's Park to ask for help. I should be asking about that. Last month, I learned about the closing of 16 beds and the cutting of 35 jobs at Aurelia Soldiers Memorial Hospital. I should be asking about that. It's mining week, and the government still hasn't invested a cent into Northern Ontario's Ring of Fire. I should be asking about that. But, Mr. Speaker, unfortunately, for a record fifth time, the government is being investigated by the OPP. So I have to ask about that. Mr. Speaker, how has the Premier allowed 5 OPP investigations to take place under her watch? And Mr. Speaker, how is it possible that not a single member of her cabinet or her staff has taken responsibility?
Well, Mr. Speaker, in terms of the decisions that we have made around investment in energy, Mr. Speaker, investment in electricity, we have made very different decisions than the Leader of the Opposition would have made. I absolutely understand that. When we came into office, Mr. Speaker, the energy system in Ontario, the electricity system, was degraded, Mr. Speaker. It needed investments. It absolutely is not false, Mr. Speaker. The fact is we have invested in over 10,000 lines across this province, kilometres of line, Mr. Speaker, across this province. We have shut down the last of the coal-fired plants, Mr. Speaker. We've invested in renewables, Mr. Speaker, and we have a clean electricity grid as a result of that, Mr. Speaker. No smog days, Mr. Speaker. A reduction in the pollutants in the air. So, Mr. Speaker, we've made very different decisions than the opposition would have.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, I asked a question about needing some level of apology or contrition on 5 OPP investigations into this government, on the watch of this Premier. And, Mr. Speaker, all I get is an example of deflection and dodging at its best. So, Mr. Speaker, I'll be a bit more specific. When Trillium Power did a Freedom of Information search looking for numerous documents back and forth with the Premier and the Cabinet Office on the offshore wind project, they turned up zero, not a single document. In fact, between the fall of 2010 and February 11th of 2011, there was numerous correspondence. Unfortunately, all the correspondence on the government side completely disappeared. So my question, Mr. Speaker, is were those documents deleted, double-deleted, or did the Liberals cancel the offshore wind program on a whim to save their own seats?
Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
When the Leader of the Opposition is talking about the Premier's office, I will remind him that I became the Premier in 2013, Mr. Speaker, just as a reminder of the chronology. And as I have said in this House, Mr. Speaker, I was not aware of any investigation until of the media reports, Mr. Speaker. If we are contacted, we will, as always, cooperate fully, Mr. Speaker. We have made changes. We have made changes in the way we deal with documents in this government, Mr. Speaker. Under my watch, we have new rules in place, including mandatory record-keeping rules and staff training, Mr. Speaker. The Accountability Act prohibits the willful deletion of records, Mr. Speaker, and creates a penalty. And in fact, Mr. Speaker, we worked very closely with the Information Privacy Commissioner of the time to make sure we got it right, Mr. Speaker, and we implemented her recommendations as we put new rules in place, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier, and since the Premier has referenced the Privacy Commissioner, let me note that the 2013 report of the Privacy Commissioner detailed the deletion of the emails in the gas plant
scandal. Deputy House Leader.
The report said the Minister of Energy's Chief of Staff confessed to deleting all the emails. At the time, this was seen as an unethical attempt to hide evidence of the gas plant scandal from the public. Trillium's lawsuit now proves the Liberals didn't just delete evidence from the gas plant scandal, they also deleted evidence from the cancellation of the offshore wind program. These could be key pieces of evidence in Trillium's lawsuit. And if Trillium wins, the people of Ontario could be on the hook for $500 million. So, Mr. Speaker, my question is, will the Premier explain to the people of Ontario and this legislature why they should pay for the potential illegal activities of this government?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I will just say again to the Leader of the Opposition, when I came into this office, we changed the rules around record-keeping, Mr. Speaker, and I will read from the information.
Premier, come to order. Next step, individuals.
Read from the Information Privacy Commissioner's report, annual report from June 2014, and what was said there. I quote, Mr. Speaker, I have appreciated the cooperation I have received from Premier Kathleen Wynne. The Premier issued a directive in accordance with the recommendations made in the report and committed the government to greater transparency and accountability. In addition, political staff received in-depth training on record retention responsibility. I applaud these developments, unquote, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question?
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. This government runs self-congratulatory radio ads at the same time as closing hospital beds. They kick kids off.
You're not helping. Please finish.
Mr. Speaker, they kick kids off the autism treatment wait list just to make the list look smaller. At the same time, they add them to another wait list. They cancel the gas plant at the cost of $1 billion just to save a few seats. They cancel offshore wind projects in Liberal-held ridings. Now the evidence has been deleted again. It's been a while since the Liberals were looking out for the best interest of Ontario. Mr. Speaker, because of that, life has got harder in Ontario. So my question, Mr. Speaker, to the Premier is, does every decision this government makes need to be about their own political surviving?
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, let's talk about the initiatives that we are involved in, Mr.
Member
Speaker,
from Stormont.
And that includes investing billions of dollars in infrastructure across this province, Mr. Speaker. We're in year three of a $160 billion
Member from Nipissing.
$160 billion over 12-year investment in infrastructure. That's roads, that's bridges, that's transit, that's hospitals, it's schools and universities, Mr. Speaker. We are in
the process of
putting in place a climate change policy, Mr. Speaker. A cap and trade system that is going to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, Mr. Speaker, and we only have to look around the world to recognize that climate change is the single most important threat that we are facing as a globe.
Now that I've got quiet to make sure I don't have to be too loud, the member from Leeds-Bren will come to order. You have one wrap-up sentence.
And, Mr. Speaker, we are investing in the post-secondary education of the young people of this province, Mr. Speaker, in a way that has not been done before.
Yeah. Supplementary.
Back to the Premier. Last week, we learned of the fifth OPP investigation into the Liberal government. This time, the government is accused of deleting key evidence in a $500 million lawsuit. Speaker, the Premier claimed that she knew nothing about it until the media reported it. But Trillium's lawyer, Morris Cooper, doubts that could be possible. He is quoted in an article in the Ottawa Citizen by David Reevely that he spoke to the government lawyers about it several times. Speaker, we're not talking about a nuisance lawsuit here. We're talking about a lawsuit that has the taxpayers at risk for a $500 million. Will the Premier admit to the legislature that she was aware of it? Or is the normal way of doing business in her government just deletions, denials, and cover-ups?
The member will withdraw.
Withdraw.
Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I have been very clear that I knew nothing about the investigation until I read about it in the media. The Attorney General has sent a statement to the Ottawa Citizen, Mr. Speaker, and if the member opposite has further questions, we can absolutely make sure that he gets a copy of that statement.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Well, at $500 million, she should have known about it.
Exactly.
Thanks to David Livingston and Laura Miller, we now know that all evidence in the Premier's office and Cabinet office about the Trillium Project were wiped away. Whoa. Well, what about the other ministries, energy and environment?
Yep.
Well, according to the Trillium lawsuit, in January of 2011, just 2 weeks before the offshore wind program was cancelled, the government decided to give the offshore wind file a code name. No surprise, Mr. Speaker, since they called the gas plant file Project Vapor. What's shocking is that this government gave orders to, quote, purge all email records and documents except for Ohio and Sweden. Mr. Speaker, will the Premier tell us what code name was assigned to the offshore wind file? And will she release all the documents saved under that code name?
Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, as I said, I knew nothing about this investigation until I read about it in the media, Mr. Speaker. It is an investigation that is taking place outside of this legislature, Mr. Speaker, as it rightly should. And, Mr. Speaker, I will read from the statement that was sent to the media last week by the Attorney General. The only information we have is what we have read in the media, and if what we have read is accurate, you should address any questions you have to either the OPP, who have been quoted as saying they are investigating this matter, or to the Public Prosecution Service of Canada, PPSC, whose counsel has been quoted as saying they have not received any disclosure on this. So, Mr. Speaker, I would advise the same to the member opposite, and I would then again refer back to my earlier answer, which is, Mr. Speaker, we have instituted training, we have instituted changes in terms of the...
Thank you. Thank you. A member from Nipissing, second time. Being sorry is not really meaningful if you continue to do it. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. More than 1,440 nurses have been fired since January of 2015. With those kinds of cuts, it's no wonder that health care is the silent crisis of this government. This morning, I stood with nurses from Toronto to call for an immediate moratorium to nursing cuts in Ontario. On the first day of Nursing Week, will the Premier agree to stop firing nurses?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I know that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care is going to want to comment, and I want to acknowledge nurses and nursing students who are here today, Mr. Speaker. Nurses obviously play an essential role in our health care system, Mr. Speaker, and what the Leader of the Third Party doesn't talk about is the nurses that have been hired, Mr. Speaker, because there are two sides to this equation. There are more than 26,000 more nurses in our system than there were in 2003, Mr. Speaker,
wow.
And that includes 11,000 registered nurses. So I know that there's been a distinction made between different kinds of nurses, Mr. Speaker. The reality is there are more nurses, and there are more nurses, whether they're registered or whether they are RPNs, in our system now than there were in 2003, Mr. Speaker. And there's a clear trend line in terms
Answer.
Of increase in nurses in the system, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
The trend line is 1,440 nurses fired since January last year. People across Ontario know that nurses are there to care for them, nurses like the ones from Windsor who've made the long drive to Queen's Park to be in the gallery this morning. When people are at their most vulnerable, Speaker, they count on nurses to be there for them. And after 4 years where hospitals didn't receive a single increase, and now with increases failing to match inflation or a growing population, hospitals are being cut yet again. For the last 16 months, that meant 90 nurses a month. 3 nurses a day being fired, Speaker.
Wow.
Over 1,400 of them since the start of 2015 alone. Will this Premier agree that no more nurses in Ontario should be fired?
Thank you.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I also want to thank our nurses who are here, our RNs, and also welcome the RNAO report that came out this morning as well, that provides us with exceptional guidance on the way forward and how we need to look at the nursing mix and our contribution that our nurses make across this province. But, Mr. Speaker, it is important to set the record straight, because we can't look at gross changes like the third party wants to do. We need to look at the net changes of nurses in this province. And every single category of nurses, whether it's RNs, RPNs, nurse practitioners, we've seen since 2003 an increase to date of every single, whether you measure it on a per capita basis, Mr. Speaker, or the absolute number of nurses, there are more nurses of every category working in this province since 2003, and that continues today, and I'm exceptionally proud of that, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, the way you thank nurses is certainly not to fire them. It's actually to make sure that they can keep their jobs. That's how you thank them. And the minister can talk about 2003 all he wants. I'm talking about what's happened in the last 16 months in this province, and that is 1,440 nurses fired by this government. After 4 years of cuts, if anything, Ontario doesn't...
Sorry. The member from Durham, come to order. I thought you apologized.
Leader.
Speaker, after 4 years of cuts, if anything, Ontario doesn't have enough nurses. There's an old saying that if you find yourself in a hole, the first thing you do is stop digging, Speaker. Patients have watched as nurses have been fired across Ontario. But let's be clear, fewer nurses doesn't improve health care for people. It hurts patient care.
Question.
So, will the Premier instruct her minister to order a directive today, or rather to issue a directive today, to stop firing nurses in the province of Ontario?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I implore the leader of the third party to begin talking about the whole change in the nursing sector.
Yes.
There are, from time to time, nurses which, because of a variety of reasons, where the jobs are lost, but other nurses are hired. And she doesn't have to believe me again, and I would ask all nurses who are listening to this and others concerned to look at the College of Nurses of Ontario. It's all there for everybody to see, and you'll see that in the past year, there were 2,799 additional nursing positions across all nursing categories. In the last 4 years, Mr. Speaker, from 2011 to 2015, there were net increases in nursing positions in our hospitals, Mr. Speaker, and the majority of those new hires, those net increases, were RNs, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Your question here, the third party.
Speaker, my second question is also for the Premier. As I mentioned, nurses from Windsor are joining us here today. Under the Premier's watch, Windsor Regional Hospital is grappling with a $20 million budget shortfall. In January, the hospital announced that 166 jobs would be cut, and now, in fact, we know that 169 registered nurses' positions will be eliminated. Will the Premier make that basic commitment today, Speaker, to stop forcing hospitals like Windsor Regional to cut frontline nursing positions, Speaker?
So, Mr. Speaker, and I would just go back to what the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care just said, which is between 2011 and 2015, the reality is that most net new nursing positions in the hospital sector were filled by registered nurses, Mr. Speaker, which is, I know, one of the issues that that the leader of the third party has been concerned about. And, Mr. Speaker, we heard hospitals' concerns about the fact that they hadn't seen increases. That's why there's $345 million new dollars, Mr. Speaker, going into hospital funding as a result of our budget. That's in the context of $1 billion of new funding going into the health care system, Mr. Speaker. So we understand that there was a need for that. And, Mr. Speaker, we look forward to continuing to work with our hospitals as they work with all of the community providers as we transform the health care system so that it meets the needs of the people in this province today and into the future.
Thank you.
Speaker, the Liberals have been cutting hospitals to the bone, and they've been doing that for years and years, Speaker. 1,440 nursing positions have been cut over the past 16 months.
Order.
Hospitals across this province are making deep cuts to nursing care to respond to the cuts that the Liberals are making to their budgets. And since January, hospitals in Kitchener, Hamilton, Ottawa, Toronto, Windsor have all been forced by this Premier and this government to cut nurses. Let's be perfectly clear, Speaker. We cannot afford to lay off another nurse in this province. Whether you're a registered nurse, a registered practical nurse, a nurse practitioner, no more nurses should be handed a pink slip in this province. Will the Premier do the right thing, Speaker, and issue a directive that no more nurses will be fired in Ontario?
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, we need to talk about net changes, because as programs disappear, even as nurses move from one part of the hospital to another part of the hospital, necessarily layoffs have to occur. But in many, if not most cases, those individuals are rehired. In the case of Windsor, they are undergoing a skill mix review and some changes. Windsor is one of the very few hospitals remaining in Ontario that has a 100% RN workforce. And I just don't subscribe to the view of the leader of the third party that our RPNs, our registered practical nurses, have no value or have no value in our hospitals. I don't subscribe to that view. I believe that sometimes there is a role, and it's up to the hospital administrations, based on good evidence and directing their administrations to focus on the quality of care and outcomes, that that skill mix needs to be determined.
Yep.
Final supplementary, leader.
Instead of throwing mud, this minister should look at the thousands of petitions that are going to be tabled in this House today, because he is firing nurses. The hospitals are firing nurses. That's why they're here on Nursing Week, Speaker, is to say stop firing the nurses in this province. For Ontarians, Speaker, the health of their family is their number one concern, and so it should be, but it should also be the number one concern of this Premier. Ontarians deserve a government that is committed to making sure that the health care system is there for them when they need it. But that's impossible when the government keeps firing nurses, Speaker. Why won't this Premier and her Minister of Health face up to the silent crisis that they are creating in the health care system and put a stop to nursing cuts right here and right now?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister?
Well, Mr. Speaker, for the member opposite the leader of the third party to somehow suggest that we are doing the opposite of what we are doing. We have increased the number of RNs in this province in the last decade by 11,000. But you need to look at the net changes. You need to look at the net changes, for example, when the NDP were in power.
Finish, Minister, please.
Mr. Speaker, when the NDP were in power, the net change from beginning to end of their relatively short period of time in government, 3,000 RN positions, 3,000 registered nursing positions were lost. The percentage of nurses that were working full-time was reduced under the NDP. We've done the opposite, Mr. Speaker. However you want to measure it, I'm proud of that record. It's worth it. Investing in our nurses, the front line, they do the most important work.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Start the clock. Thank you. New question. The member from Halliburton, fourth of Lake Rock.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. When it comes to remaining silent on workplace harassment, the government's ad campaign says it's never okay.
Never okay.
In last Friday's Niagara Falls Review, we now learn that a former female employee of Kim Craters said she was bound by a non-disclosure agreement. When asked about the harassment allegations made against Craters, she said, "I just can't say any more about this." Can the Premier tell us, was the non-disclosure agreement tied to the settlement of the sexual harassment complaint, or are these women free to come forward to tell their stories?
Well, Mr. Speaker, as the member opposite knows, one of the women did come forward and talk to the media, which is why, Mr. Speaker, I then made a statement. I have made tackling the issue of sexual violence and harassment a priority, Mr. Speaker. It has, when I've been faced with an issue of sexual harassment, I've led by example. I made a statement on Friday. If a sexual harassment complaint is made against a Liberal MPP, an independent investigation is undertaken, Mr. Speaker. And if that independent investigation determines that serious misconduct has occurred, then that MPP will no longer serve in my caucus, Mr. Speaker. Yep. And you know, in that process, there are confidentiality issues that arise, Mr. Speaker. And I was not prepared until one of the women had come forward to breach that confidentiality. And I would think that the member opposite would understand.
Thank you. Supplementary, before you can stop the clock. I heard something very unparliamentary, but I could not assign a person. I hope it doesn't happen again. Please finish.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. I would be shocked if the Premier's office were found to have muzzled victims of sexual harassment, but the media does beg the question. It looks like the silence that the Premier has obtained is not meant to protect victims, it's meant to protect the Premier. If I'm wrong, Mr. Speaker, then Michelle Tavano and all the other victims would be free to tell their stories. It is a sad day for women in this province to learn that the Premier will do anything to save her own political career. So, Mr. Speaker.
Stop the clock. Deputy House Leader, second time. Come to order. Please finish.
So, Mr. Speaker, when it comes to silencing the voices of victims, why is it never okay except when you're the Premier?
Well, Mr. Speaker, let me just say that if the member opposite thinks that removing an MPP, requiring that an MPP is removed from office, that that protects me and that that protects my party, Mr. Speaker, then she doesn't understand how politics works. Mr. Speaker, it is the complainant and the victim's choice whether they retain confidentiality, Mr. Speaker. And again, I would say to the member opposite that I would think she would understand that in order to create an environment where people feel free to come forward, they need to know that their complaint will be confidential, Mr. Speaker, and it is my responsibility. And quite frankly, I would say that there has not been an environment in our culture that would promote the coming forward by people who have been sexually assaulted, who have been sexually harassed, Mr. Speaker. It is my responsibility to create an environment so that more people will come forward, and confidentiality and the respect for confidentiality is part of that.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. New question. The member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, on Friday, the Premier revealed that she asked former MPP Kim Crater to resign because of allegations of sexual harassment. In response, Crater said, and I quote, "I do know that the party paid them," meaning the victims, "to keep the allegations quiet and had them sign a non-disclosure agreement not to talk," end quote. A former staffer in the MPP's office has confirmed that she was bound by non-disclosure. Speaker, women should not be forced to go public with allegations of sexual harassment, but they should not be muzzled either. Did the Premier require the complainant to sign a non-disclosure agreement, and did she pay her to keep quiet about the allegations?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I have to say I'm really surprised by both of these questions. I really think that these questions demean the experience of women who make complaints, Mr. Speaker.
Order, please. And someone is tiptoeing around a request that I've made many times about using names. Thank you, Premier.
Mr. Speaker, when a complainant suggests that a confidentiality agreement be part of a resolution, then of course we agree to that, Mr. Speaker. And I respect
the member from Renfrew, come to order.
I respect that right of victims to ask for confidentiality, Mr. Speaker. I spoke out on Friday because one of the women in
the member from Lanark, come to order.
Came forward and spoke to the media, Mr. Speaker. And that is why I made the statement that I did. But otherwise, Mr. Speaker, I was respecting the agreement of confidentiality that was in place.
Thank you. Yeah. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. An editorial today rightly points out that secrecy about sexual violence and harassment does not serve the public good. Rather, it signals to victims that there is something to be ashamed of. Requiring victims to keep quiet, making them sign non-disclosure agreements, and paying them for their silence does nothing to help survivors heal. Instead, it often protects perpetrators, and in this case, it prevents embarrassment to the Liberal Party. So again, to the Premier, were victims paid to keep quiet about allegations of sex?
Stop the clock, please. Minister of Education, second time. Member from Durham, second time. Please finish.
If so, who ordered the payoffs and where did the money come from?
Mr. Speaker, the confidentiality agreements that were in place were mutually agreed upon, and I'm going to read from our policy, Mr. Speaker, because I don't know whether the opposition parties have workplace discrimination and harassment prevention policies that they operate by, Mr. Speaker, but I'm going to read from ours, the section on confidentiality, and it says, this policy recognizes that it can be difficult for a complainant to bring forward a concern of discrimination or harassment. Individuals making complaint of discrimination or harassment are assured during that investigation and consideration of a complaint and following its resolution, all information relating to the complaint will remain confidential. However, both complainants and respondents must have access to sufficient information about the allegations and responses of other parties and witnesses to allow for a fair and effective participation in the resolution process.
Answer.
That's the process that we followed, Mr. Speaker, and I am not prepared to breach the confidentiality of victims and re-victimize them, Mr. Speaker.
Start the clock. New question. Member from Trinity Spadina.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Education.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. If it happens again when I sit down, I'll deal with the individual. New question. Member from Trinity Spadina.
Thank you again, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Education. Investing our youngest learners has always been a priority of our government. In 2014 Ontario budget, the province made a commitment to invest $750 million over 4 years to support school capital projects that reduced access space. And last year, the province announced $120 million over 3 years in new funding dedicated to building safe, high-quality, licensed childcare space in our schools across the province. Minister, last Friday you made an announcement about funding for new projects under these programs. Speaker, through to the Minister, can she tell this House about the new renovated school infrastructure announced last week? Thank you.
Minister of Education.
Yes, and I want to thank the member for Trinity Spadina for the question. And every year, Ontario funds local school infrastructure projects to provide students with better places to learn and give young children and their families increased access to safe, high-quality, licensed child care in schools. And over the past few weeks, I've had the pleasure of visiting various communities in Ontario and make capital announcements. But on Friday, we did the wrap-up and announced that this year Ontario is investing $137 million to build new schools, expand or renovate existing schools, and create new child care spaces across the province. This year, that adds up to 20 such projects, including 4 new schools and 16 additions and retrofits. Additionally, families in Toronto, Kingston, and Oshawa will benefit through the construction of 19 new custom-built child care.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Minister, it's great to hear our government continues to improve the learning environment for our students.
Wow.
We know that schools are hubs for our communities. They are spaces where children gather to learn and play, and for programs that benefit children, families, and community. I know students and parents in my riding of Trinity Spadina are excited to have the funding approved for St. Raymond's Catholic School and the addition added to St. Luke's Catholic School. Minister, can you tell us how a project qualifies for capital funding under this program?
Good question.
Thank you, Minister.
Yes, thank you, Speaker. And these projects are actually part of the largest investment in public infrastructure in the province's history, about $160 billion over 12 years. Speaker, that will support 110,000 jobs every year across the province with projects such as roads, bridges, transit systems, schools, and hospitals. In terms of qualifying for the funding, we consider funding projects under the School Consolidation Capital Program that allow a board to reduce their excess capacity. Projects need to generate sufficient savings to warrant the investment in new space or renovated space, and where required, need to have completed the corresponding accommodation review. Our government is very proud to invest in these capital projects that bring students together and bring communities together and provide better buildings.
New question. The member from Stormont, Dundas, and South Glengarry.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Minister of Government and Consumer Services. The Minister, like his colleagues, has an obligation to ensure in-person services at Service Ontario outlets are there for Ontarians who need them. Instead, he plans to close 9 Service Ontario outlets, forcing residents in my riding and other rural communities to drive long distances to get the services their tax dollars pay for. The minister doesn't appear to be making any attempt to guarantee in-person interaction in local communities. Speaker, decisions over planning, agriculture, energy, and others have left small-town rural Ontario behind. Is this just the latest cut, just another scheme to make Ontarians pay for your government's mismanagement?
Thank you. Minister of Government.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I appreciate the question from the member opposite, and obviously understand his concern. This is a very important issue, as Service Ontario conducts about 50 million transactions each year, Speaker. We are proposing to continue to maintain 277 offices across the province. The one the individual is referring to, in fact, has one staff person in it, and there are a number of other alternative locations. We wanted to make sure that customers in Ontario and all Ontarians would have good quality service. In fact, customer satisfaction surveys indicate about 98% are very satisfied with the service. We are also moving more services online, Speaker. More than 40 services are moved on are online right now, and we continue to see an increase in that area. Speaker, happy to add more in the supplementary.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, while he may want to cut costs, the minister has no excuse for cutting in-person services for Ontarians who can't and shouldn't be expected to drive to another county to get the service. Speaker, the Auditor General warned that the interest of this government's reckless debt will crowd out public services. Is this what the Auditor General warned us about, or will the minister commit to preserving existing in-person public services in rural Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. And there obviously continues to be services in rural Ontario in these areas. This is a very thoughtful approach. I know it's difficult, but it was one that was evaluated and analyzed for well over a year to determine how we could modernize and make more efficient the services delivered through our ministry, and we continue to take a responsible approach with this regard. Guiding principles, Speaker, in these decisions were preserving the quality of customer service and ensuring that the capacity could be absorbed in surrounding areas that are no more than 28 kilometres away in every location. And those top three services, driver's license renewal, val tag stickers, health cards will continue to be available in all of the surrounding locations, Speaker. This is, I know, a difficult decision that we've had to make in our ministry. It's part of our modernization for Service Ontario, and we continue to see more services online, Speaker.
New question, the member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Finance. Instead of fixing Hydro One so that it delivers affordable, secure, and green power for all Ontarians, this government has prioritized making money for shareholders, while at the same time driving up rates for customers. Last Friday, it was announced that Hydro One shareholders will be paid more than $36 million in dividends. On May 1st, electricity prices in the province went up yet again. This is the eighth time in a row that rates have gone up by more than 9% over the previous year. Speaker, my question is simple. When will this government start putting the interests of Ontarians first?
Thank you. Minister of Finance.
I appreciate the question, and I think the member opposite fails to recognize that the majority of that dividend are for the people of Ontario, are for the taxpayers. We're the major shareholder, Mr. Speaker. And as a result of the improvements that we've made to this corporation, it now operates more effectively, the dividends are increasing, and it's contrary to what the member actually stated earlier, that this deal is in fact better for the people of Ontario, better for the ratepayers in the end, as we reinvest where necessary. At the same time, we're reinvesting in new infrastructure that wouldn't otherwise be available to us. They deny that opportunity, Mr. Speaker. We will not. We're helping the people of Ontario, and we're investing to make it even better.
Supplementary. What a load.
Speaker, Ontarians don't need to be convinced that this government is mismanaging the electricity file. Don't need to be convinced. 85% of Ontarians want the province to stop the sell-off of Hydro One. 85%. The Financial Accountability Officer says that the sell-off of Hydro One will make Ontario worse off by $500 million a year every year. Businesses say that sky-high electricity prices are damping down growth in this province. And the OPP is once again, Speaker, investigating the government for deleted documents over the cancellation of a multi-million dollar energy contract. Speaker, when will this government stop making Ontarians pay the price for its short-sighted and self-serving actions?
Minister of Energy.
Speaker, further to the Minister of Finance's answer, what I think the member fails to realize is the proceeds that came from the IPO, Mr. Speaker, $5 billion goes towards reducing the province's debt. Already, Speaker, we are
member from Kitchener,
we are reducing our interest payments already by $100 million a year, Speaker, as a result of this transaction. So not only are we getting investments for infrastructure, Mr. Speaker, in the Trillium Trust, we're also bettering our fiscal position by reducing the interest we pay on our debt by $100 million a year. And as we do the next tranches, Mr. Speaker, the reduction in interest payments will be higher, Mr. Speaker. So we're very, very happy with a better-run company, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
And we also, Mr. Speaker, are providing many mitigating programs for people, including, Mr. Speaker, tax deductions, which represent $400 million
a year. Wow. Thank you. New question. The member from Barrie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. Last week, we recognized Children's Mental Health Week in Ontario. Now, more than ever, the well-being of the Indigenous children, youth, and families is in the spotlight. Indigenous communities in Ontario face challenges in accessing supports for mental health, child welfare, specialized services, and youth justice. I understand that our government is working with First Nation, Métis, Inuit, and urban Indigenous partners to develop a strategy to support Indigenous children and youth in Ontario. Through you to the Minister, Speaker, would the Minister please tell us how our government is engaging with Indigenous partners in the development of this strategy?
Good question. Thank you. Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Thank you. Speaker, our government is committed to helping First Nation, Métis, Inuit and urban Indigenous children in Ontario get the best possible start in life. That's why the work that we are doing together with the First Nation partners on the Ontario Indigenous Children and Youth Strategy is now more urgent than ever. In fact, last week during Children's Mental Health Week, I had the pleasure of joining Minister of Children and Youth Services for a very important roundtable with First Nation leaders from across Ontario, including First Nation youth. We heard from First Nation leaders and youth about the tragedies, the challenges, and the solutions of these issues. The involvement of First Nation leaders and youth is the key to the development of our strategy. It ensures that they have a voice in the development of community-driven, integrated, and culturally appropriate supports for First Nation youth and their families here in Ontario. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, for that response. My supplementary question is for the Minister of Children and Youth Services. It's great to hear about the hard work that the ministers are doing to improve outcomes for Indigenous children and youth in Ontario. I would like to thank both ministers for their leadership in bringing First Nations leaders to discuss how we can work together to develop solutions to these important issues. I understand that the work of our government is doing to address jurisdiction over child care is just one part of the Ontario Indigenous Children and Youth Strategy. Can the Minister of Children and Youth Services tell us more about the significance of last week's roundtable meeting with First Nations
Question.
Leaders.
Thank you, Minister.
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And I want to thank the member from Barrie for this very important question. And last week's roundtable did highlight the many ways we're working across our government to improve mental health and well-being of First Nations children, youth, and their families. One of the topics we talked about, Speaker, was the need for a critical path forward on advancing jurisdiction on child welfare, which our government is committed to, working with our partners and the federal government on this. Honouring First Nations jurisdiction over the well-being of children is a vital step going forward in this process. That's why jurisdiction over childcare is one of the pillars of our government's Ontario Indigenous Child and Youth Strategy. It's also why we will also be engaging with Métis, urban, Indigenous and Inuit partners to develop solutions to the unique challenges that they too face in addressing issues surrounding child welfare. Thank you.
New question. Member from Halliburton, Cortland-Strong.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. The former employee of Kim Crater told the media, "I just can't say any more about this." The Premier said she disclosed Kim Crater's name because this woman came forward. Will the Premier set aside the non-disclosure agreement and allow Michelle Tavano to tell her story?
Here, here. Well, again, Mr. Speaker, as I said, the woman came forward, and she is free to talk and tell her story as she sees fit, Mr. Speaker. Confidentiality agreements that are in place are mutual, Mr. Speaker, and I'm not prepared to breach a confidentiality agreement, Mr. Speaker. I'm trying to create an environment where people feel free to come forward, and that when they tell me or they tell someone in our government, or they undergo an investigation, Mr. Speaker, and they are assured of confidentiality, that confidentiality is kept in place, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, it's clear Michelle Tavano wants to tell her story. I'm sure the Premier would encourage all women who want to speak to tell their stories. Is Michelle Tavano free to tell her story without fear of being sued or having to pay the money back?
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, the
member from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke, second time. I don't need any other armchair quarterbacks either. Premier?
My first concern is for the victims in these situations. And
You know, I hear the heckling from the other side, but it's actually quite the contrary. My concern is for the victims. My concern is for the people whose lives have been so negatively affected by these situations, Mr. Speaker. And it is up to the victims. It is up to them what they choose to talk about publicly or not. And, Mr. Speaker, I will always respect the confidentiality of the victims, Mr. Speaker. I will not engage in a process
Answer.
That will re-victimize them. And I would have thought that the member opposite would have felt the same.
Member from Lanark, come to order. Second time. New question. The member from Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. On Sunday, an editorial was published telling the Premier that the way she is reducing the wait list for autism therapy is, and I quote, all wrong. This decision has left parents devastated. Hopes for their children have been crushed. The editorial argues that kids already on the wait list and in the program should get the treatment they need, that they were promised, because it's the right thing to do, the fair thing to do, and I believe the Premier knows it. Capping treatment based on age is not only wrong, but it's discriminatory, as former Liberal Premier McGuinty once said. Will the Premier do the right thing and immediately remove the age cap for children receiving access to intensive therapy behaviour?
Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister of Children and Youth Services is going to want to comment. I had the opportunity when I was in Ottawa last week to meet with members from the Alliance Against the Ontario Autism Program, which is the group that has been talking, one of the groups that's been talking to us over the last number of days, Mr. Speaker, and I had an opportunity to talk about how this change, Mr. Speaker, is intended and is being implemented in order to get children, whether they just started getting service, whether they've been sitting on a waiting list for years and haven't had any service, but to get them to the right intensity of service, Mr. Speaker, to move them into service right away. That is the whole point of this, Mr. Speaker, because it is unconscionable that we would keep kids on a waiting list, not getting service, Mr. Speaker, when we have the opportunity to move them into the right level, get them an assessment, Mr. Speaker, and help them through that transition so they'll get a tailor-made program for themselves, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, this Premier is moving them from one list onto another. That's what's unconscionable. It's not just parents who are concerned, it's experts too. And the school boards are wondering how they will support an influx of autistic kids who haven't received therapy. As the editorial states, quote, to suddenly strip children and families of hope to which they have clung, sometimes for years, is too cruel a way to save money, end quote. Speaker, I agree. It's cruel to try to balance the books on the backs of kids with ASD. Another article about autism says that in this Premier's Ontario, it has become abundantly clear that some special interests are far more important than others.
And question. Quote,
will the Premier finally admit that she got this one wrong? Will she remove the age cap from children with ASD receiving evidence-based intensive therapy immediately?
Services.
Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, from the same articles I've read, from talking to groups and experts and parent groups, there is a lot of agreement, Speaker. There is agreement that $333 million is a wonderful historic investment. There is agreement, Speaker, that 16,000 new spaces for children with ASD is very important. And it's very important. I encourage, again, the opposition to be very clear in what they're saying, because we are not removing children from the IVI wait list into nothing. Zero. They are currently, unfortunately, not getting service, and they will get service immediately with the payment of the $8,000. As for schools, Speaker, the Minister of Education is very actively engaged on this file. We already have children with ASD in schools, and we have programs and services to support them. Is there more to do? Yes, in fact, I'm meeting with the Minister tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you. Your question, the Minister from Burlington.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister responsible for the Poverty Reduction Strategy. I know that the Local Poverty Reduction Fund, or LPRF, is an important component of our government's renewed poverty reduction strategy. The LPRF funds community organizations providing innovative and local solutions to poverty in their area. I read it in the budget that last year, the LPRF funded an impressive 41 projects in 20 communities across our province, meaning that hundreds of lives are being impacted with locally based solutions, an exciting number to see. However, I wanted to know more about the projects that were supported through the LPRF. Speaker, through you to the minister, can you tell us more about the local poverty reduction fund and what kind of initiatives were supported through the first round of funding?
Thank you. Minister responsible for poverty reduction.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member of Burlington for the question and her ongoing commitment to this issue. Speaker, the Local Poverty Reduction Fund invests in initiatives that help break the cycle of poverty for children and youth.
Member from Hamilton East, Stoney Creek.
And end homelessness in Ontario. One such great example is Up With Women, Speaker. That Up With Women is one of the organizations that received a grant from the first round of Local Poverty Reduction funding, and they're here today, and they starred in the national news last night, Speaker. They're all about helping recently homeless and at-risk women to build sustainable, empowering careers with the goal of helping them permanently exit poverty. So today, they've joined us. We celebrate them. Celebrate them on Mother's Day, Speaker. And since working with Up With Women, these moms have been able to access support and transition into new...
Supplementary.
I'd like to thank the minister for her answer, Speaker. I'm delighted to hear that Ontario is investing in frontline community organizations like Up With Women.
Thank you.
And I would also like to welcome our guests here today. We applaud you for all of the challenging things that you've done and for the exciting work you're doing now. We are so pleased to welcome you to Queen's Park. I'm also very pleased to hear that the first round of funding for the LPRF has distributed funding to such valuable programs, but I know, too, that the fund is a six-year, $50 million total investment. There is definitely more to come. Minister, I know that all members of this House are interested in the fund's potential for their communities, so could you please share with us the next round of funding, when it will be available, and how interested organizations can apply?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Information on the second round of the Local Poverty Reduction Funding is available on the Ontario Trillium Foundation website and on ontario.ca/poverty-reduction. We'll be accepting proposals until early June. For this year's round of funding, we're dedicating up to $10 million total targeted for projects related to homelessness. The dedicated funding will help reach this government's bold goal of ending chronic homelessness in 10 years. We've also dedicated at least $2 million in this round to support projects in Indigenous communities and by Indigenous-led organizations. I want to say thank you to my parliamentary assistant, Speaker, the member from Newmarket Aurora, for his work engaging with a variety of Indigenous leaders and community members to make the application process more accessible and ensure the program is more responsive to Indigenous communities.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker.
Good question. The member from Perth Wellington.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Community and Social Services. The Minister's office was informed that her seamless rollout of SAMHS was flawed from the get-go. But she plowed ahead anyway. She inflicted chaos on the system, chaos that came with a hefty price tag of almost $300 million. Now municipalities and service providers have been left to foot the bill for significant overtime costs, extra staff to handle the problems with SAMHS, and in some cases, even new equipment in order to run SAMHS. Speaker, municipalities are not responsible for paying for this government's mistakes. Will this minister finally take responsibility for the SAMHS disaster and reimburse municipalities for their expenses?
Thank you. Minister of Community and Social Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I've said many times in this House, we do acknowledge that the rollout of SAMHS posed many, many challenges for frontline staff. And I want to take the opportunity yet again, and I met some just last Friday, actually, in terms of the challenges that they faced, and they worked very diligently through those challenges. Of course, as the member has alluded to, I was given assurances that, in fact, we would
not be facing those types of challenges. However, as he's referencing assistance to municipalities, to date we have helped municipalities with an additional payment of some $15 million to assist them through the transition, and I know that this has made a great deal of difference to those municipalities. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the money the government has already provided comes nowhere close to meeting the need. Brantford and Brant County require $600,000 to cover the problematic rollout of SAMs. Ottawa has estimated they need $4 million. In Waterloo Region, the costs add up to more than $1 million. Hamilton needs at least $820,000. Stratford passed a resolution calling for a permanent fix to SAMs, as they estimate they spent $175,000 in the months after SAM's release. And the list just keeps going. It has come to the point where legal action is being considered to recoup these expenses. Will the minister do the right thing and reimburse municipalities and their taxpayers? Or is she going to add millions in legal fees to the massive SAMS bill?
Question, thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And of course, we've been having ongoing discussions and conversations with municipalities, including the ones that the member referenced. And I'm in an ongoing discussion with those particular locations. And the dialogue continues. Apart from the $15 million that I referenced earlier, we are looking very specifically at those centres. If they have some additional costs, I know I and my officials are very open to looking at their particular concerns. In fact, it was the city of Brantford where I visited early on, and I was pleased to have the opportunity to talk to frontline workers in that city. They did have some particular difficulties that were unique to their location. And so the conversations will definitely continue, and we will
Answer.
Try and see what we can do to mitigate their concerns as we go forward. Just one last piece. I think we all remember that the SDMT situation introduced by that party cost
$400. Thank you. New question, the member from Parkdale-Hyde Park.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Mr. Speaker, in December 2013, the Premier apologized to the survivors of Huronia and said, quotes, "We will protect the memory of all those who have suffered, help tell their stories, and ensure that the lessons of this time are not lost," unquote. Yet in discussions on the future for Huronia, the survivors have been left out. The Premier's apology are empty words if the survivors of Huronia are not part of these discussions. How can the survivors expect to be consulted about the future of the Huronia property when last fall the government did an investigation of the sewage pipes of the institution cemetery and didn't share the results with the survivors? I've had several conversations with the Minister of Economic Development and received no answers. They want to know if any bodies were disturbed in the
Question.
Cemetery. Will the Premier commit to honouring the survivors and engaging with them in discussions about the
Thank
future
you.
Of Huronia?
Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I appreciate the question from the member opposite, and I had the opportunity to express to her last week that I'm very concerned that we do work with the survivors as any changes are made to this site. I think it's a wonderful site. I visited it very early on when I was an MPP because I had constituents whose children had been there from the time they were 2 years old, and they were 50-year-old men at the time when I visited them, Mr. Speaker. So it was a very poignant visit that I made, and so that impressed upon me how important it is that as we go forward, whatever happens with this site, that we are very sensitive to the grounds and we're very sensitive to the usage going forward. So we are we commit to working with the survivors, Mr. Speaker, and I know that there is a more involved discussion going on with people in the community who have ideas for how they'd like to see the site used in the
Thank
future.
Thank you. Really the member from Thorn Hill.
Just want to introduce in the members' gallery Asfandiar, who's now better known as Aspie, Wadiwala, Jimmy Yu, Julia Cosby, Amira Hashabi, Sheriff Sabawi, Daniela Shivvu. Welcome and bienvenue.
Thank you, Attorney General, on the point of order.
Mr. Speaker, on behalf
On behalf of the member from Ottawa Centre and the Minister of Public Safety and Correction, I'd like to introduce in the gallery Matthias Faulkner, Caroline Faulkner, and Bert Marin, who were here to watch Paige Benjamin Faulkner. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to take this opportunity to wish my wife, Diane, a happy anniversary for putting up with me for 39 years.
Member from Newmarket, Aurora, in front of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to welcome constituent Damien Walsh, father of Paige Leah Walsh, to Queen's Park today.
Thank you. We have a deferred vote on the motion of second reading of Bill 186, an act to establish the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan. And calling the members, this will be a five-minute bill. Members, take their seats, please. Members, take your seats, please. Thank you. On April the 20th, 2016, Mr. Bradley moves second reading of Bill 186. All those in favor, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr.
Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms.
Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantal.
Mr. Vantal.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natasha.
Mr. Natasha.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gelina.
Madame Gelina.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Mr. Montat.
Mr. Montat.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time to be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Arnold.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller, Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole. The ayes are 68, the nays are 24.
The ayes being 68 and the nays being 24, I declare the motion carried.
Second reading of the bill, deuxième lecture du projet de loi.
Pursuant to the order of the House dated May 5, 2016, the bill is ordered referred to the Standing Committee on Social Policy. There being no further deferred votes, this House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon.